Now we have greater access to seeing them happen in front of us. It gets confusing and sometimes painful. But in the end, love sets it all free. So that's love. It's the only answer.
From the soul, y'all.
Greetings, world. Welcome to Meet Them Mondays on Jolt Radio. I'm your host, Cristian Portilla. And today, joining me in the studio are Alessandra Mondolfi, Melanie Olivia, and Veronica Urrea. All three ladies are creatives and artists who are changing the way we consume and participate in art. Welcome, ladies.
Thank you.
How's everybody doing tonight?
Very well.
Why are you guys being so quiet?
I can get closer to the mic so we can hear you.
So we were just talking about how we were all doing Art Basel. Mm-hmm. So how was Art Basel for all of you? How are you feeling now? What's going on? How was this past week for you?
My Art Basel was amazing. I loved it. It was really rewarding. It's really exciting. We were actually just talking earlier today about how it's the beginning of something. People think that the week is over, so we pack up, go home, and like go back to life, which we do, but now life is also part of like incorporating everyone that we've met and reached out to and talked to and connected with. So it's really exciting. I have like a list of people that I want to like connect with again that we met and reach out again. I was representing a couple artists at Superfine, and Superfine is an amazing artist. It was really fun to work with them again.
Which is funny because I was just telling Alessandra and Melanie how we had met, and so this show we were going to kind of do it in like a really different style, only because for the first time ever on the history of Meet Them Mondays, I have a guest that we're all meeting together for the first time ever.
Yay!
Yeah.
Hi.
And so you two were actually busy during Art Basel. What were you both doing? Melanie, you can go first.
We were actually involved in a really fun project by Michelle Pred of California. She curated and organized a parade against patriarchy. So we marched on Miami Beach with a great group of women. We had our art that spoke to intersectional feminism, and we really created a stir on the beach and galvanized a group of people that I will echo what B said. I think we're going to stay connected now and reach out and collaborate in the future. And it was good for that this year, for sure.
Nice.
Alessandra?
This Art Basel was a lot chiller than the rest. Last year, I wanted to do it all. I was really excited. I planned everything till the 11th hour, and this year I decided to chill out a little bit. As Melanie said, you know, one of the highlights was participating in the parade against patriarchy and doing something on the streets outside of the white walls of institutions. And then my other highlight, something that I was really excited about, was FAIR, which was first time ever an art fair inside the Greece Frickle City Mall that was all female artists and nothing was for sale, and talking about fair market and fair representation. So, and coincidentally, both of these things happened to be, you know, feminist issues, although, as we will talk later, I'm not a feminist artist, but both of those events were really happy.
Awesome. Okay. I'm glad you guys had a good Basel. My Basel was good. I'm glad because we all connected some way, shape, or form through that. So it was pretty busy, but it was also really good. And so we'll get back to the march that you all did. But I just want to begin by asking about your work. So maybe, Alessandra, you can go first. Talk to me about your work, what it is that you do, and how do you describe that to other people?
Well, it's complicated. My creative practice has forever been all over the place. It encompasses a lot of things. I've done a lot of commercial work. I've done fine art and everything in between. I've worked in theater. I've we've done a lot of different things, last year my work took a turn into the activist realm, mostly out on the streets or in social media. So I've been designing and fabricating what I call props for protest and deploying them out in street marches, street protests, in groups, but I've also been doing solo sort of performances and actions on the streets, and then creating videos and content for exclusively for social media.
Okay, awesome. And Melanie Oliva.
Yes, correct. I moved here to Miami from Chicago 3 years ago and really delved back into fine art. I'm really from the advertising world, but I've always been an artist, so as I started to explore what I wanted to do with my art, I really noticed all the environmental issues that we have here in Miami. It's really the ground zero for climate change and sea level rise. And that really started to inspire and influence my art practice and started to connect with activists here working on different issues. And really, my art has become about creating empathy and being a voice for the voiceless. So whether it's in the environmental world with an animal that's threatened, or whether it's actually marginalized groups of people, it's kind of all connected, and it's really inspired me to kind of galvanize people together and create a couple of artist collectives. So I have the Artful Activists, which addresses social and environmental issues, and then also Inspiration Pollination, which is specific about pollinators, trying to give them a voice because they're really threatened right now. So as much as we as artists can do to help them, I think we should and can.
Awesome. And then Veronica, we'll take it to you. What is the Visionaire Collective? And for the listeners out there, basically what happened with us was that we met at Superfine over the weekend, and you were telling me about what you're doing, your new project that you started, and just kind of on the spot, I was like, hey, you know what? Come on over. Come to Meet the Mondays, and let's talk about what you're doing, because you represent artists, and we have artists here that could totally be represented and have their work out there more. So let's talk about what you do.
Absolutely. So I moved to New York City about 5 years ago now, and I've always been a creative, and like Melanie, I actually have created a professional background in some marketing, some finance, and just, you know, kind of delved into more of the professional world, and I took that skill set and was able to kind of bring it to the arts. I felt that artists in general didn't have the support system that they necessarily needed, and I was really interested in trying to create a community and a support system for them that would make them feel not only celebrated, but also kind of add some savvy and figure out like some strategies on how to help them monetize their work, really. You know, creatives don't always get what they're worth, and I think that it happens so often. And so being able to celebrate them, inspire them, and that kind of led to inspiring me to create Visionaire Collective in support of them. I love the way that we met. It's so serendipitous, and I think that a lot of things since I started pursuing this have happened in that way. It's just kind of been a natural progression of like hearing, you know, echoes of different artists kind of talking about, you know, what it's like to be a creator of something and still have to be the brains behind marketing and monetizing, and then how do I pay my rent, but also do what I love, and that's such a passion for me. So getting to help people do that, it's going to be really rewarding.
That's awesome. Yeah, we can all totally relate to that, especially being creatives and stuff like that. I don't know about for you ladies, but maybe in your fields and stuff like that, sometimes you kind of have to wear like so many hats and do all of that. So we'll come back to you. But Alessandra, I want to start with you, because the work that you do is political. It can sometimes offend people who may not see things the way you do. And you really motivate people to come together. And so I want to talk about that message. And I want to talk about how you, what you think about what people might, how, like, what's the approach when you tell people, or when they see you on social media, or how they interpret your work, and how they interpret, like, protest art. And please feel free to speak your mind. Yes.
Yes.
I see you cringing already.
No.
I see you cringing.
Like I said, the political, I've always been politically involved, but I've always done so quietly and behind the scenes. This year has been something very new to me, really, really outside of my comfort zone. But I just felt like I didn't have a choice, and I had to step up and do whatever I can. And at moments, I've made an absolute fool of myself, and that's okay by whatever means necessary. I don't think I can honestly tell you what the reaction to the work itself is. I mean, in Facebook, we tend to be a bit in our bubbles, so I do get a lot of, you know, likes and positive comments from people that I know. And then there's always, you know, the trolls and, you know, some hate mail that at first I found very disturbing, but at this point I'm actually collecting it. And I think I might try to do something with it.
Okay.
I think it speaks a lot about the reaction to my work. Sadly, if you read some of the responses, you know, the grammar and the spelling, I think can then give you an indication of a certain sector of society that the message is coming from. So I don't know what or if I'll do anything with that. You know, one of the projects that I started was called No Hate, and a lot of the hate mail may be a background wallpaper or something to an installation. It's been fascinating. Shockingly, what I've gotten the most response from has been the necklace. I, believe it or not, I'm an introvert. I mean, once you get to know me, I won't shut up, but I have a hard time engaging with people in the first place, and I've been wearing the necklace now for 8 months. I actually feel naked. Like, I can't leave the house without it. And
what's the necklace for people out there, since we're on radio and they can't really see it?
So I make these, you know, cardboard props that I carry on the street, and they're all double-sided, and they have an issue that I'm opposed to, and you know, the counter argument that I advocate. So I've made miniature versions of them that I carry on my neck, and they're all political statements. And it has been the most interesting social experiment, because I have people from every walk of life come up to me and talk and get straight to the point. There's no, I'm not very fond of you know, light fluffy talk, and it has allowed me to meet some really interesting people that I would have never otherwise met, and it has allowed me and other people to engage directly in some really important conversations. Even Trump supporters. I met somebody at an opening a few weeks ago, talked to them for about an hour, made friends on Facebook, this and that. They liked all my pictures. I ended up going to their site, and right on top it says MAGA.
What?
And I start going through their feed, and I wrote back. I said, you know, it was really lovely to meet you last night. You know, I'm sort of shocked to realize that you're a Trump supporter. And, you know, the response is like, we know, we didn't have the heart to break it to you, you were so interesting, we loved your work, and blah, blah, blah. So, you know, it has, I have engaged with the other side. I don't know if that answers any of your questions.
It does, it really does, and I find it so interesting because I'm asking you about your work, but there might be people out there that don't know about your work or don't have you on social media. So I wanted you to kind of talk about that. And a lot of your work is, like, against Trump.
Absolutely.
I follow you on Facebook. I see your updates. And, you know, it's funny that you say that you made friends, because I actually lost a lot of friends. And when I saw that happening, I was like, oh, you're one of those people, you know? And it really polarized, like, a lot of the feedback that I was getting online. But now, moving that over to you, Melanie, the work that you're doing, when we first started talking about the show, which we'll get into the next beat, we were talking about how I felt like a lot of the work that you both do together is feminist, or is, you know, like, smash the patriarchy and things like that. But your work is actually also different in that you speak about other issues as well, like climate change and talking about the pollinators and the bees. So let's talk about what inspires you and what your type of work is and how you express that.
Yeah, I kind of started with environmental issues. It was just something, growing up in Nashville, Tennessee, I grew up near a forest preserve, and love animals and love nature, and I just gravitated towards that when I started painting again. And from there, I just took it to activism too. So I started combining activism with the art, and I would use painting to. I was inspired by our friend John Bob Carlos to use the painting for petitions to get more likes on Facebook, because if a petition has a great image, that can help. So things like that, and starting conversations. I also write, so I write articles about issues, but I kind of curate the article with artwork from different people to try to create more empathy around an issue. And that actually worked for me getting a resolution passed in my area around the Florida black bear hunt. And once I saw that that worked, it really inspired me to keep going more. And I was like, wow, I can actually kind of change policy in a way with artwork and with an article and with changing someone's emotions. And a lot of times I think activism is missing that art component, because just like science is. So that's kind of inspired me to connect more people so that we can do things together, because I think science needs art, art needs science, so that our artwork is based on something factual. And it's not just a pretty picture, but it's something that means something. So that's kind of inspired me as far as activism. And then after the election, I had this idea for the Artful Activist, because I saw what was happening when people were coming together and the power they had when different kinds of people come together and use their different skill sets. So I had this idea to bring artists, activists, and gallerists together for the Artful Activist. And it was just one of those things that's like, I'm gonna make an app. But I just kept putting it off. And then the election happened. And it was like literally the next day, I was like, okay, I'm doing this. And I just made a secret Facebook group and started adding people that I thought could were interested, because everyone was so fired up at that point. We wanted to do something, but we didn't know what it was yet.
For the Artful Activist.
Yeah, for the Artful Activist. I feel like a lot of creatives and artists wanted to do something after Trump was elected, and we just weren't sure yet, but sometimes creativity takes a while, and I've learned a lot about that. Sometimes it's some melding of ideas, and you need other people to inspire you, and so it kind of took a little bit to get it going, but once we had a good group of people, and then I met Alessandra, that even changed it more, because she brought more of the social issues, made it more to the forefront for me, so I started incorporating that more into my artwork and started realizing, wow, social issues and environmental issues are so tied together, and you can't really fix one without also addressing the other. So that's kind of been the evolution of my work, and I still am a painter, but I've also started delving into street art, I guess, by making props and carrying Alessandra's props, which is really fun because her props are awesome. Yeah.
Actually, talk to us about that prop that you made, the Smash the Pin Tricky. Like, can you describe it for us?
Yeah, it's actually a big pinwheel. So the kind of pinwheels like little kids have that the wind carries and spins. Since this was a parade, you often see pinwheels at parades. So. And I think Alessandra and I had actually been talking about, what are we going to make for this? And Alessandra was kind of making her props. And I was like, I want to do something that spins. I was inspired by, I don't know if anyone saw the Trump piece. I think it was in the Philippines, that had these arms that spun around. I was like, we need to take our protest art to the next level and actually make it kinetic and like work on the painting and make it a little more detailed. So she was like, I think you even threw up the idea of the pinwheel. I just wanted it to spin. But having her just say that, I was like, oh yeah, that's perfect. So I had the idea for the fist, and it's actually a pinwheel of fists of all different skin tones, ethnicities. I put little details on them, like there's little tattoos, so it's actually different genders to represent just fists from all different kinds of people. Actually smashing the patriarchy. So the center of the pinwheel says smash the patriarchy. So when the wind blows, it looks like the fists are actually moving and smashing it.
Oh, nice. Okay, awesome. And so you and Veronica are kind of like connected in that way, because you started a collective, which was, and you have it more online based, but your collective is different, where you represent these artists. And when we spoke, you had told me that it just so happened that you have women that you're representing. And so I'm kind of curious to know who these women are, what type of work they're doing, if it's political, if it's not, like, What's your story on that, and how did this collective come together for you and the Visionary Collective?
Yeah, actually, I think what really gave Visionary Collective such momentum was that I was working a lot, especially in the past year or so. I had attracted really amazing, strong women into my world. We kind of just gravitated towards each other. We started working with each other on each other's projects. So I do represent female artists. My team is largely made of women at this point, which in my past lives has not always been the case. It's really interesting. Like, I don't know, some of us joke a lot that, you know, we tend to kind of like be one of the boys, and now we're just kind of like one of the boys together in a girl gang. So it's funny and it's fun and I love it. The artists that I represent right now, I wouldn't call their work as much feminist as I would femininely empowered, if that makes sense. Like, I think that when you look at their work, it's very clearly made by just very empowered women, which I'm so proud of. That's actually a conversation that came up with both of the female artists I represented at Superfine, Ashley Chi Gardner and Yada Vudovic. It was Ashley's second time showing at Superfine, and it was Yana's first time showing at Superfine, so I was really proud to be able to represent them, you know, particularly at Art Basel, you know, during Art Basel. So it was so rewarding, and both of them just have, like, really empowered pieces that just, it's great to hear feedback on. It's great. Yana's booth was actually painted. Superfine is very encouraging of emerging artists, and they let us paint it whatever, however we wanted. You know, we have total control and freedom to be able to display the art however we see fit. And Yana painted her entire wall red. Like, so you could spot her booth a mile away, right? And I walked up, and there was this very nice gentleman talking and he was speaking with her, and she came up behind us, and she's this, like, 6'5", you know, blonde, radiant woman, and he was saying, like, you could tell, like, a very, Jesus, like, I feel like I could tell a woman made this. This is definitely female energy, but it's a hell of a woman, you know, like, and I was like, yes. So she came up and they, you know, were able to connect. It was great to hear, you know, somebody say something like that. So it's, I don't think that it's art specifically for women or made, you know, by women. I don't think we see it that way. We're very much about it being an even playing field, and we like being able to celebrate talent, regardless of, you know, whether it's not made by men or women. I just happen to be blessed to have a really strong group of women around me.
Awesome. If you're just tuning in, you're listening to Meet the Mondays on Jolt Radio. I'm here in the studio with Alessandra Mondorti, Melanie Oliva, and Veronica Urrea. I'm your host, Lisa Portilla. And so I want to bring it back to a topic that we were talking about right before we got into the studio, which you were bringing up earlier. And I kind of want to turn it over to you because you wanted to ask about feminism and how, like, that kind of shifts and combines with art. And so I was like, you know what, like, we have space for that. Of course, let's talk about that. So what was what you wanted to ask, Veronica, that you were talking about it earlier?
Well, as I said, as I just finished saying, I don't even know how to form it into a question as much just to say, like, I consider myself a very empowered female, and I feel very lucky to be a woman. Like, I love being a woman. It's one of the things that I really cherish in my life, and I feel like a lot of my power that I've found comes from being a woman. So I'm curious as to how, just, I've never really related to myself as being a feminist because I don't usually, like I said, I think that the future is human.
Mm-hmm.
I actually wrote a piece for International Women's Day. We had a big show in New York City on March 8th, and I remember, I'm a writer, like, that's my way of expressing myself creatively, and I wrote a whole piece, and at the end of the line, I remember thinking, like, if tonight is female, I really hope the future is just, like, human, and, you know, it's, I love that it's a part of my life. I think that's like a ribbon of my canvas, but it's never been like the whole picture to me. I'm just curious as to how you guys see it and like what feminist movement means to you guys. I'm curious about it.
Melanie, do you want to go first?
Yeah, it's funny because Alessandra and I have been talking about this, mm-hmm. as this leading up to the show. Neither of us identify, I guess, as feminist artists per se, because our work certainly represents the gamut of different issues. But I like what you said, B, about being empowered women. And I feel like that's how I see myself. And in the art world specifically, in a way, I mean, women are really trying to catch up still in the art world. It's very male run, I would say, and a lot of, if you go to galleries and museums, you're going to see mostly artwork from men. So it's a tough space to be in, and but I think we've both felt more empowered the more things we do, and we have been able to, in the parade we were just in this week, the Parade Against Patriarchy, we have been able to address those specific issues. But it's interesting also to, because that the patriarchy actually affects all issues in a way too. It's all connected, and but yeah, I do like talking about this because I think feminism plays out in so many different ways, and without just saying I'm specifically just a feminist, or we often pigeonhole ourselves. I think we don't have to.
It's funny because when I thought about doing this show, the reason why I thought we all sort of shared something together and why I invited all of you was because I knew the type of work. I was familiar with Melanie's work and with your work, Alessandra. And I remember seeing the female symbol, the hand prop, and thinking, oh my God, this is really interesting, and especially that she came from our city and that she is putting this work out there. And so when we were outside, we were talking about feminism, and I even titled the show, like, we're talking about feminism, but then when we were outside, you said, like, you know, I do relate to these issues, and I do agree, but I'm not just a feminist, and I know you were very vocal about that, Alessandra, so what were we, you want to bring that up, and how sometimes that might be something that we get pigeonholed into, or especially for you as artists?
When I first received the invitation, I was really excited, but I did see the title as, you know, feminist artist, and I'm like, that's not me. And I almost turned the opportunity down, and then I thought about it, and I actually talked to Melanie. I said, listen, you know, like, the work that I've done has, at moments, addressed feminist issues, but it's also addressed issues like, you know, whether it's immigration or healthcare or climate change, which in a way are feminist issues, and they some of them disproportionately affect women. It is a known fact that, you know, what is being called now as the resistance, and the resistance, you know, it takes many forms against, you know, many issues, is being led by middle-aged women, which sadly, I'm middle-aged, but I happen to be a middle-aged woman, and I'm proud to be part of that group. Again, as we speak about feminism, there is a lot of emphasis in the intersectional section of feminists, which is something new that is happening, and that is an absolute must, and that intersectional, you know, means that it encompasses all, that it is bringing together different social classes, different races, different even, you know, on the scale of gender. So I think of that intersectional even further than just including everyone, but including all issues, including the social and the environmental. I'm not an academic, and I don't, you know,
it's okay.
Expect to be speaking with quotes and background studies. But in my mind, I think that feminism has to include everything and everyone.
Okay, awesome. When we get back, we're going to take a quick little break, but I do want us to talk about what the patriarchy is and the work that you're all doing, and we'll get back to that. We'll be right back. Okay, awesome. Remember, you have 1 minute. How's it going here? I do want to talk about the future, like, in the best thing in terms of the law, but may not always be broken down. And, like, I don't know if we spoke about this, I think we have spoken about it, but, like, now is the time where all of these topics are coming out. Like, even the song I chose, like, Pussy Power, and honestly, like, you know, the Me Too campaign, course, this is less about your art, it's less about these times that have women that are out here showing things for these that is actually the tune that's about that thing. That was it? You were lying, you were really fast.
Yeah, except for
and I do want to make sure we talk about inspiration calling in the on Jolt Radio. I'm your host, Cristian Portilla, and you were just listening to Pussy Power by Nidhi Scott, which I love, by the way. Have you guys heard her music? Mm-hmm. She's really great. So we were just getting into switching it over to like the feminist topic and talking about the patriarchy. What is a patriarchy, Marini, for people out there? It doesn't have to be textbook, but sort of an idea for the listeners out there, because I think it was it in one of your articles that I read, that or was it Alessandra's, that someone had asked, like, what is the patriarchy? And it was a man asking what it was. And so you said, you know what, if a man is asking what that is, that's really good that we have the time to talk about that. So for our listeners out there, what is the patriarchy? How can you describe it?
I think in short, it's a system, an institution that we're all very used to. It informs everything in the world. It's, I don't know if I want to say male domination, because that sounds very negative, but I think it's, I think we are used to, as women, kind of being in the background in a lot of different careers, industries, and in general. And if you start to step back and really look at that, you see how the patriarchy informs everything. I don't know about a textbook definition.
Definitely not.
Definitely.
You don't have to take your pick,
yeah.
Don't worry.
But that was when you were talking about the story with the man asking about the patriarchy. I was the first one to arrive at the Parade Against Patriarchy on Miami Beach, and I had this pinwheel with me, and I had my pink hair. And this man was like, are you selling something? I was like, no, but I'm going to be in this parade if you want to come. And he's like, what's it all about? And he saw my smash the patriarchy sign, and he had the guts to say, what is the patriarchy? And I think that's a lot. I mean, to really admit that you don't know what that is. And he's like, is it male domination? I was like, yeah, basically. I mean, give a little bit more context around it. And he's like, oh, okay, that's cool. Yeah, I might stop by.
And let's talk about that march that just happened. So how did you all have the idea to create it? And especially where the march was walking around, it was on the beach, which was a lot of foot traffic was going on because of Art Basel. So a lot of people were seeing what was going on. How did you both come up with the idea, or how did it all start? Like, what was that? What was that about?
Was actually led and curated by Michelle Pred of Oakland, California, and I think this was the first one that she organized.
The first parade against the patriarchy.
Yeah, I think she's planning on doing more, and she already knew a good base of women who do feminist art and who do social practice art, and she was going to be here for Basel, so I believe she just organized it. It was good timing because a lot of artists were coming here, and she does do mostly feminist artwork, and she's been doing that for a long time, and I think she had the same idea of bringing it out to the streets and just kind of creating a stir. There's obviously a captive audience during Basel on the beach, so we happen to know Michelle through the artful activist. I had a connection with her and through another friend, and we got to be part of it and meet a lot of great women.
I wanted to bring the question to you, Alessandra. How do you feel in terms of the power that it holds to be able to gather a group of people and bring them together for a common idea? What is that like for you, especially since you've participated in other marches and putting your art out there for everyone to see and to show, like, sort of use your art to kind of define what the message is? How is it like for you when all these people come together and carry your art and you use it for that reason, you make your protest art for that?
The act of taking advantage of your First Amendment right and going out to the streets and voicing your concerns and your opinions is incredibly empowering. I had protested in the past a couple times, but never to this extent, and never with the idea of creating, these a little bit like street theaters. It would happen sort of on its own. I used to go up to Vermont in the summers to go see the Bread and Puppet Theater, which is an incredible street protest theater group from the 60s, and have always loved their work and has always sort of lived within me. And it sort of came to the forefront, and I started, I don't have a shop, I don't have tools, so I started working a little bit in that vein. They work with paper mache and very low-tech materials of using recycled materials and working really quickly because issues were happening so fast that there wasn't time to fine craft these pieces, and they were meant to be on the streets. And more than anything, I realized that while there are many artists that are doing things within the gallery and the institutions, it's great, and I think that it has to be done, and it's being done more and more. I feel that there is an incredible value for it to be out in the world for many reasons. One of them is that this battle, this resistance, is happening on the media, and it's happening, on the TV and the newspapers and social media, and they are always looking for the visuals to back up these stories, and the visuals really matter. And as artists, we have the tools and the creativity to create those visuals to, advocate and to bring attention to the issues that we are fighting for and we are concerned. And, being able to catch somebody's attention on an article because of that visual is really important. So putting those visuals, putting the message out there in a visual matter, especially in this day and age where everything's just so quick, these sound bites, and more than ever, and historically artists have created, the visuals and the propaganda for social change, and it is happening more and more now again, and it is really inspiring. And through this whole process, we've met people from all over the country and actually the world who now we have this rapport, and we're constantly sending things to each other and feeding off of each other. And when we feel defeated and demoralized, we have a community saying no, we are making progress, and we're all putting in our little grain of salt, and we are a massive collective. And I am happy to be part of it.
Do you remember where you were or what your first piece of protest art was?
It's actually really funny because I wanted to participate in the Women's March in D.C., but I couldn't. And a local group, Exile Books, organized at the Standard a poster making session.
I love Exile. I've written about them before.
Yeah, they're cool.
Yeah.
And so they had gotten a crate donated to ship all these posters. They invited people to make posters for them to be sent to D.C. There was a gallery in D.C. that was receiving them. They were going to be distributed. And I attended, saying, well, this will be cool. I can't be in D.C., but I'll be there through. grabbed a bunch of construction paper and some scissors and glue, because I'm not everybody was painting the posters. I'm more of a 3D person. I ended up making a collage, which I thought was really cute. Put it in the crate, took a picture of it on and put it on Facebook. And somebody wrote to me saying, oh my God, can I have a copy of your poster? And I was like, you can't have a copy of posters. It's a collage. It's in a box. I don't even have one. And they're like, well, maybe we can print this image. So even though it was a cell phone image, I touched it up a little bit and we printed it. It looked great. And I offered it online. People started using it. And the poster itself went viral and got used in marches, in the DC march. It got used in Boston. And we used it here in Miami. I ended up creating a 3D version of it for Miami. It wasn't anything that was planned. Again, everything happened so fast. And
but what was on the collage that people were so drawn to?
It was really graphic and very simple. It was 4, 8, 11 of those female symbols in different shades of pink against a black backdrop. And it ended up, women had it as their profile pictures, as people started emailing and I started sending the file. And
wow.
it was very, and that really empowered me. And then we did the 3D activation here and people got involved and I got to meet some cool people, and that's reaching out to Miami community, which I knew nobody was like, I have all these props, I need people to carry them. And I ended up meeting several people who have participated in other of the actions that I've done, and it was never planned. It's all been this response, this sort of very emotional, immediate response.
And so, just to put like the idea together, your female symbol that these women were holding at the Women's March, they were the one that you created from that poster?
Right, the poster was two-dimensional
like
in a sense, so I made armbands, and then I made a big centerpiece, and we had a couple posters printed, so we were a sort of a three-dimensional version of the poster.
I remember when I first heard about you that someone told me, you know those symbols that you're seeing on TV, that you're seeing everywhere, Alessandra, an artist in Miami, created those, and I was like, what? You mean someone from Miami made those? Like those female symbols? And it was just like the image went everywhere. You know what those are, right, Vee?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, I want to.
Well, I didn't create the female symbol.
No,
I mean, that's
no.
That's
no.
I will not take it.
No, not the female, the art.
Right, the armbands with
yeah.
It. Yeah, I did. It was fun. It was a powerful image, and it's now part of the collection that Michelle Pratt is in, Melanie's in. There's a woman who collected all of these pieces from the Women's March and now towards the future, and it's in a touring show called Still They Persist.
Mm-hmm.
And that armbands.
It's actually four women called the Femme Four, which is
Femme
awesome because it's four women, empowered women.
Yeah.
Touring this artwork around,
yeah.
And collecting women's work.
And so is that how you two met? Through this artivism that we were talking
mm-hmm.
about earlier?
So it was actually the women's rally. Alessandra made those awesome props. I swear, we walked by, we had not connected yet, and I saw it out of the corner of my eye. I saw them holding it. I was like, that looks so cool. I got home, and I had an email from artist Stuart Sheldon, and he was connecting Alessandra and me, and I had missed the email, and it was asking, can you be part of this art activation? I was so upset. My husband will tell you. I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't know I could have been part of this. That was so cool. And I was seeing all the pictures come up, and I was like, wow, there's someone else in Miami who's making cool stuff, and I want to know her. So we actually went to, after the immigration stuff was happening, when they're detaining people at airports, I was like, I just have to go. Like, I wanted to go and be there and protest, and my husband went.
The travel ban.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Alessandra.
The day the ban was instituted,
yeah.
Everybody took to the airport.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Alessandra was there, and I had seen on Facebook she was going to be there, and I was like, I have to go and meet her. I just have to meet her. So we went, and we met her, and we talked the whole time, and like, ever since then, we've been connected and making stuff together.
Awesome. Okay, so Alessandra puts like the image, that image to sort of some of these protests. And for you, Melanie, you also, with your art, you also give an image to some of these environmental issues. So one of those is your project Inspiration Pollination.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell us more about that.
Yeah, it's an idea that I had to kind of bring first of all, I was inspired by the pollinator issue in 2015 when the White House came out and said, this is an issue, bees are dying at a rapid rate. And I was like, what can I do? Like, my husband and I thought about becoming beekeepers. We're like, well, how could we make this bigger? And with my advertising background, I was like, we could make like big letters that say something and they could be beehives. And we're like, no, we're gonna get stung. We don't know what we're doing. So I was like, wait, I have a simpler idea. It just like, ideas come to me in the shower. I don't know about you ladies,
yes.
But I had this idea in the shower.
Yeah.
All
the time.
Right?
Same for me.
You're so relaxed.
Yeah.
So it just came to me in the shower and I was like, yeah, I could just ask people, or I know so many artists and I know so many people in advertising and creators and makers, and I could just ask them to like make their next project about bees and about pollinators. So I made this group online, and now it's up to I think 875 people, and it's actually inspired people to also become beekeepers, to create pollinator gardens. So they're not only just making artwork about it, but they're actually doing things that actually help the animals too. But it was really to create awareness, because the government at the time, they were not spreading awareness. In fact, there's no regulations about pesticides in this country, hardly. So in a way, they're doing the opposite. So yeah, I was like, what can I do? Artists are powerful. And that really inspired me to keep going and take it further. So every year I've kind of added things and gone to new levels with it. And actually, one of the things that scares me in a way is 3D. And Alessandra is really good at that. I'm more of a 2D person. So for Inspiration Pollination at the March Against Monsanto, I'd had this idea to make, you know, like the Chinese dragons at different festivals they have. I wanted to make something like that, but a monarch caterpillar. So I was like, well, I could probably do it. But it was nice to know that Alessandra was there to help and fix my messes, because I made it, but then she helped. And she's like, no, if you do this, it'll be better. It was really cool, and we had people wearing butterfly costumes, and actually Alessandra and our friend Pete Gonzalez were so nice, because they dressed up as characters that were supposed to be workers, Monsanto workers, and it was such a hot day. It was like 90 degrees outside, and they had these masks on, and they had like the big suits on, but we filled the bottles instead of pesticides. They're filled with water, so they're spraying everybody. And
cool.
It was cool.
Yeah, that's nice. And so you represent artists, you represent like what they do, what their work is, mm-hmm. And you were telling me that you most recently represented Wu-Tang, and so it's different what we're all doing, but in essence, art is here, and that is what moves us. You told me the story, but tell us more about how that happened, and what it is that...
Yeah, absolutely. I collaborated with... The first ever videographer of the Wu-Tang is Gerald Barclay, and he grew up in Staten Island along with a lot of the guys. And by complete chance, can I tell you how I met this guy?
Absolutely.
This isn't exactly what I mean by serendipity. It's such an amazing story. I was sitting in the back of an office really late at night. I thought I was the only person there, and I was feeling just kind of restless. And it's a full moon. Anyone who knows me personally knows like I'm such a moon person. I'm just one of those people.
Yeah.
And I get a text from one of the artists that I partner with regularly and a friend, and he sends me this text of him. He's a graffiti writer, so he sent me a text of a picture of him like tagging up the wall, and then the background he had added a Wu-Tang song to it, and he knows I love Wu-Tang, and I'm like, yes, that Wu-Tang, you know, whatever, we're going back and forth. And I was so grateful for it at the moment, because like I said, I had this really like heavy like kind of restlessness on me, and somebody comes out of the office out of nowhere and is just like, hey, you know, that's Wu-Tang, you took it back with that Wu-Tang. And I was like, yeah, like, who are you and why are you here? And we end up spending like 4 hours talking about how he's Gerald Barclay, and he was one of the first to ever work with the Wu-Tang, and he did their first videos in the first 10 years of their career. He shows me original footage of them like recording Cream and like all of these like amazing classic, you know, 90s tracks, and I was just like, I couldn't believe it. And he tells me he's releasing a memoir. So a couple weeks go by, and he knows that I'm a writer, and he starts sending me, like, you know, editing. We start, like, you know, talk about editing notes and things like that, and I just took a chance, and I was like, listen, let me have your book release party. You know, I can have these guys, you know, come through. We could do, like, an art gallery meets, you know, memoir meets music event. And he was just kind of like, really? You think you could do that? Like, I, you know, like, no budget, no real, like, plan. I was like, I got this. Like, I can do this. I know I can. And he was just like, okay, babe, I'm going to trust you. And he did the entire way through. Like, he completely trusted my vision, and it was a really great event. We got amazing feedback on it. I was able to bring on the artist that had sent me that text that night. He actually came and showed some of his work along with another artist. Their names are Leaf and Nixie Kirk, and they were both able to display their works inspired by the Wu-Tang. You know, we had some of the guys come out, and it was such a great night. I think that what's so funny about art, I totally agree with you guys, that what I really love is being able to create a community of artists that come together, and then that way people feel supported within each other. You know, like these guys, you know, this graffiti writer meets, you know, pop artist meets, you know, videographer, now writer, you know, and it's these three guys that, you know, don't usually maybe like intersect very much socially, you know, and or you know, artistically even. And it's really great to be able to bring them together and create something bigger than any one of us, you know. I think that's an art. I mean, that's wonderful at that.
And to say that, I think it was, well, we were talking about this earlier, and Alessandra had said that women and in the art world, and I know you experienced this too, Melanie, of being represented, of having your work out there, of it just not being on the white walls, you know. It can be very difficult. Well, yeah, Alessandra and Melanie, because I have read, you know, other things that you said about it being difficult when you were first putting your work out there. And so the Visionary Collective, which is your company, the one that you started, represents these artists. Who are some of the artists that you're representing? What is some of the work that they're doing?
So the first artist that ever asked me to represent her was Ashley G. Garner, a really dear friend. And we've partnered on some different events and projects together at that point. And she had just really started presenting her latest collection at the time, which was Synesthesia. And it's this really wonderful...
She was at Superfine?
Yeah, she showed
his... Her.
Yeah, exactly. You met her. She was showing at Booth 29. It was really great because we got to do like a staff booth of all the Superfine members. So Demi was also there, and James Milley, and Ashley had just really started to kind of start presenting Synesthesia, putting it out into the world more, and that was just earlier this year. It feels like lifetimes ago. And she asked me, like, hey, you know, would you be able to come on board? And
so
at that point...
So for people out there, synesthesia is when you see sound, or you taste something... I can't explain,
but it's an intersection of the senses. That's exactly what it is. It's like when you can taste sound and hear flavors, and it's a really amazing way to kind of describe the way that you experience this piece that she made.
Yeah.
It's a video series that she was able to tie in with music by Alluria, which was based on the solfeggio frequencies, which promotes wellness and kind of an elevated state of being. Similar to the patriarchy, actually. So, you know, the classic tones that we're used to was not always the case. So veteran frequencies actually came before them and were able to kind of promote human healing and human awareness and human development and evolution and elevated state of mind. I did not know that when I first met Ashley, and she kind of started explaining it to me, and I became so intrigued by the idea of combining that. What she was doing is combining that old tone scale with color therapy and, you know, water and just like all of these really like stimulating visuals. So when she brought me on, I was kind of like, I've never represented an artist before, and she's just like, I know you can do this. So, you know, we ended up showing a couple months later for the first time at Superfine. It was amazing. She's since had a few different solo shows. We just showed again at Superfine for the second time, and it's been such a great ride. She's now started a new collection, and Synesthesia has turned into Aesthesia, which is now going into chapter 2, and we're talking way more about adding technology and different features to it to really bring it to a different level of sensory indulgence and really kind of taking things to an entirely different... It's really the marriage of art with technology, and I think that that's going to be kind of the next chapter for not only this project, but I think a lot of projects. It's going to be a different way to experience art altogether.
Yeah, absolutely, and I'm kind of glad that we all have, like, a seat at this table tonight, because we have artists merging with you who, on the other end, represent artists and all these different topics, and especially about the different work that's going on right now and stuff like that. And so we're kind of reaching the end of the show. We have 5 minutes left. But I do want to talk about how people can connect with you. How can they connect with the movements that you're creating, and for V, how they can connect with you to represent them as artists. So maybe, Alessandra, you want to go first?
Sure. Alessandra Mondolfi on Instagram. Alessandra Mondolfi on Facebook. I know that just today we've got a couple of people reach out to us for some actions that are being planned. Obviously, at the beginning of next year will be first year anniversary of President-elect's. And there are many actions that are going to be planned around that time. Ellen and I have been brainstorming. There are some already organized events. We will be doing things for that. And there's a couple things coming up in December. So if you follow on Instagram and on Facebook, I'm generally posting, you know, we're looking for people, we're doing this, and there's things going on.
So the community
the
can
way.
Connect that way?
Absolutely.
Okay, awesome. And for Melanie, how can the community stay in touch with you and be a part of your Facebook groups and what you're doing?
So if anybody can be part of Inspiration Pollination, it's a public group on Facebook, if you look it up, and you're welcome to contribute or just enjoy the art. And then if you'd like to be part of the Artful Activist, it's about 250 right now, different artists, activists, and galleries. Email me at theartfulactivist@gmail.com. And basically anyone who emails will be part of it. It's just, I want to make sure it's like a real person. And then they can also follow The Artful Activist on Facebook and Instagram. And they can follow me, Melanie Oliva, artist, on Instagram, and Melanie Oliva on Facebook.
Okay, awesome. And Veen, what about you?
Yeah, you can go to my website, is www.vs4.org. Our Instagram is Visionaire Collective. We just created a Facebook page as well called Visionaire Collective, which I'm still trying to kind of get situated on. My personal Instagram is the New York Import, all spelled out. And then, or you can also find me on Facebook, Veronica Urrea, U-R-R-E-A.
And do you represent all different types of artists? Are you open to that?
Yeah, I think the most important thing for me right now is to really find people that we align with, who want to be a part of a community, and who are just ready to really contribute back. I want it to be like a symbiotic relationship. We have a few different events coming up. We helped create an international artist residency earlier this year, and we're going to be doing that again next year. So we have a few different projects lining up. Really exciting stuff.
Awesome. And I want to use the few minutes that we have left to kind of shout out someone that is doing the work that you are doing, or maybe someone that you would like to work with, or someone who is out there and you're just really admiring what they do, even if it doesn't have anything to do with what you're working on. You have one?
I want to shout out Lisette Morales. She is amazing. She's another female artist that we've been working with a lot. She lives in Naples. And she and Sandra Yayati organized the Artist March there. And they're just both very empowered women. They're doing so much. Both of them are involved in art, photography. They also are really good at marketing. I mean, they just do everything. So kudos to both of those women.
Awesome. Do you have someone in mind that you would like to work with or that you would like to represent for the Visionaire Collective?
You know, the minute you said it, the first person that came to mind was Ashley's favorite artist, FK Twigs. Ashley always, like, whenever we're hanging out at the house, she'll put on all her stuff for me, and I really come to realize that she represents and embodies a lot of, like, community-type projects, and it's very much about connectivity versus, you know, and connectivity and community, and it's not just about the commercialism, which I love.
Awesome. Alessandra, I think my wife at home who's listening is probably like doing a little dance because she loves FKA so much.
Ashley
yeah.
and I met her this week too. She's amazing. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. FOMO.
I know.
Alessandra, do you have someone out there that you are looking up to right now that you admire the work that they're doing or that you want to shout out?
There's so many people that I admire. I think most recently, the artist JR has been blowing my mind. The pieces that he's been doing on the border, and the truck from the Inside Out came through Miami, so his work is incredible. But that's as an individual artist. We've connected with some groups around the country that are doing amazing street resistance work. We Make America is really great, Rising Resistance New York. But there's tons of artists that are out there that inspire me, and more every day. Like there's slowly so many more just stepping up to the plate and doing just humongously inspiring pieces. Thanks to every single one of them.
Awesome! Thank you all so much for being on today with me, for sharing this time with me.
Thank you, everyone.
Out there. You are listening to Meet Them Mondays on Jolt Radio, and make sure to check back next week on the 18th for a new episode. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Yo, I love JR.
Oh my god. I have got the wickedest crush on him. Like, I am just like, drool.
Yes. Who's JR? Now I feel like I'm like, who's JR?
Dude, the horse is incredible.
Like, yes. The that just came out too, on the Golden Globe. Faces, Places. It's all about the Mexican border piece.
I haven't seen it.
Oh, what? It just came out like a month ago, too.
Faces, Places? Do I just Google JR?
JR. Like, and you'll be blown
follow
away.
Follow him on Instagram.
But
he's
what's his Instagram?
He's been doing stuff JR. All over the world.
JR?
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Because he's one of the
favorites.
The work, it's just so simple. And so effective, and it's gotten, you know, monumental, and it's just, plus it doesn't hurt that he's working cute.
It's like grand.
Sorry.
Bye guys, thank you so much for tuning in. I'm gonna go ahead and shut this off.
Human way. It's amazing.
No, it's...